Well, I want to welcome everybody to this very, very interesting debate that was organized by the Milbank Tweed Forum in cooperation with the Center for Law and Security. I'm sure you wouldn't be here if you hadn't known. I think anybody who's been breathing the last couple weeks would knows about all the cascade of revelations that we've had about NSA collecting data and other kinds of surveillance. We decided, because there's so much going on and there's so many different kinds of surveillance and they raise different kinds of issues, we decided for today to focus only on one aspect of this situation, and a very important one, which is the program within the National Security Administration of collecting what's called metadata from telecom companies. That means the records of numbers called, incoming numbers and outgoing numbers, the length of time of the conversations, and other subscriber data, but not including the content. And what we've learned is that over many years, the NSA has been collecting and storing all in the information about every single phone call within domestically within the United States as well as abroad. And then they're accessing it in, under more limited protocols, but the primary focus of discussion, we probably will get into both aspects, but the primary focus is simply the fact that without any suspicion at all, the NSA has been collecting, without any selectivity, simply the entire universe of metadata about Americans' telecommunication. So that's the subject for today. We have three terrific panelists. I also was asked to announce, I'm going to try to do this briefly because it's not our topic, but I was asked to announce that this Monday at noon, there's a program over at the Brennan Center, and which will include lunch, unlike today. So from 12 to 1:30, there's a program for NYU students and faculty to meet senior staff at the Brennan Center and hear about the work that they're doing. That will be 12 to 1:30 in Lipton Hall, which, as you all know, is across the street. So for today's discussion, we have a terrific panel. Each of them has a very extensive resume of activity and accomplishment in these areas. If I just touch on the highlights, that alone will take up almost all of our time. So I'm not going to even try to do that. I'll just introduce them very briefly. Stephen Bradbury on my left is a partner at the Dechert firm in Washington. He has very extensive experience representing telecom companies on many issues, including con law and administrative law issues. And before joining Dechert, he was, among other things, he was the acting assistant attorney general heading up the prestigious Office of Legal Counsel at DOJ. That was during the Bush administration. Liza Goitein on my immediate left has been a trial attorney in DOJ, and she also served as counsel to Senator Russ Feingold when he was chair of the Constitution Subcommittee of the Senate Judiciary Committee. Right now, she's the co-director of the Brennan Center's Liberty and National Security Program. She also writes very, very extensively on a wide range of liberty and national security issues. Finally, on the far left, Shane Harris is a journalist who's covered national security issues for many years. Currently, he's the senior writer in this area for Foreign Policy magazine. His reporting has won many of the top awards, and I just mentioned specifically his book, The Watchers, which is about the post 9/11 rise of the national security apparatus. And that book also won a wide range of awards and recognition. And I'll just give one example. The Economist magazine named it as one of the best books of 2010. So we have a very, very knowledgeable and accomplished panel. The way we're going to run this, even focusing only on metadata, there are lots and lots of issues to discuss. One of the most important may be simply whether it's legal or not. We just learned yesterday and reported in the newspaper this morning, the FISA court issued its opinion explaining its basis for concluding that the metadata collection was legal. That's a, I think, 47-page opinion that was just released late yesterday. So there's a lot to be said on this subject. Many people, of course, have already challenged the analysis. I made a decision as moderator, a dictatorial decision, because not all my panelists agreed with it, but I made a decision to take the legal issues off the table. It was my judgment that this issue is so embedded in statute and precedent and many legal nuances that with a wide audience of, and different levels of familiarity with the legal materials, I didn't think we could really have a profitable discussion. But the materials are out there, and certainly if any of you is interested, you can read the FISA court opinion, you can read the DOJ white paper defending their position, you can read critiques of it that have come from the Brennan Center, the ACLU, and so on. So the legal issue is very important, but we're not going to talk about them today. What I did think we should discuss, I identified three issues. I'm going to ask each of the panelists in turn to address them, and I'm going to limit the panelists to 5 minutes each on each question, so that that will be approximately 45 minutes. Yes, 45 minutes, and that should leave us about a half an hour for discussion with the group, which I think probably be the most enlightening part of this. So the three questions I'm going to ask them, first of all, granting that the bulk collection of metadata can be useful, not everybody agrees with that, but for the most part, I think we're going to assume that there is counterterrorism value in this data, but the question is, does it also pose significant dangers to First Amendment and Fourth Amendment values? And the second question I'm going to ask is whether there are alternatives that could serve most or all of the counterterrorism purposes at less risk to First Amendment and Fourth Amendment values. And then finally, the last question is going to focus on the question of oversight. So I'll begin with the first question, and this one we'll simply take it alphabetically. So Stephen, could you start? The question is, granting that bulk collection can be useful, does it or does it not pose significant dangers to First Amendment freedom of speech, association values, and Fourth Amendment privacy values?
Okay, well, thanks, Steve, and thanks very much to the law school and the center and the forum for inviting me. I appreciate it being here. And I'm glad to see that not half the audience left when Steve said we weren't going to talk about the legality in the law school. But I actually may stray a little bit beyond the lines and touch on, because you can't talk about First and Fourth Amendment values without talking about the Constitution, and that's law. And also I may say a word or two about the utility of the program. Key word is metadata. What is that? For this program, we're talking about telephone metadata, and that means in this case, what's in this database, what's collected from the telephone companies, is simply data tables showing phone numbers, what phone numbers called what other phone numbers at what time and for what duration. So there's no content of any communication. Nobody's listening to any phone calls through this program. And there's no other information, personal or otherwise, about the subscribers to the phone service. These are records that are kept by the phone companies in the ordinary course of business for billing their customers and for resolving billing disputes. It's the phone company's own records of the calls. So no content. And therefore, because there's no content, there's no private communications or record of private communications here in this database, there really isn't a First Amendment chilling effect that I think a court would recognize. And there isn't a Fourth Amendment privacy interest because there's no personal revelation, there's no private communication. There's just this metadata, which is essentially the technical data that the phone company registers when someone makes a call. And in Fourth Amendment jurisprudence, Supreme Court and the courts of appeals have consistently said there isn't a privacy interest in that data. There isn't a, at least a reasonable expectation that that information is going to be kept private when you place a call, because the phone company uses it for its business purposes. It's out there on the network. You don't know what they're going to do with it. There may be regulations that control it, but the individuals making the calls don't. So I don't, it's not at any event a significant intrusion into First or Fourth Amendment values or interests. I really don't think it's it is one at all. I mean, I think the courts would say, and it really is a sort of the legal theory behind the collection, the courts would say there is no reasonable expectation of privacy in this data, and therefore it's not a search to collect it. It's business records that are collected through what is the equivalent of a subpoena, and lots of administrative agencies issue subpoenas to companies, for example, that they regulate to get these kind of business records. Certainly not on this scope and scale, but it's similar. Here, because it's under the Patriot Act provision, section 215 of the FISA statute, it has to get approved by a court. Many administrative subpoenas that agencies issue every day don't require any approval from a court. So there's a greater protection in the fact that the court is approving it. But I grant that it is extremely broad in terms of the amount of data, which is kept for 5 years and then deleted from the database. But the reason there's so much data is because it's necessary to have the full or as full a set of this data you can get to see the connections between a number that you have a reasonable suspicion is associated with a particular terrorist organization overseas, and you take that number and query it into the database, and that tells you if it's talking to other numbers. It shows you the links and the connections to other dots, other numbers that the persons, the FBI in this case, who's investigating that terrorist organization, doesn't know about. So this is a tool for identifying new phone numbers and new suspects in the FBI's investigation of terrorist organizations overseas and the threat they may pose to the United States. And this is a unique tool that enables the FBI to see when those overseas suspects or suspicious phone numbers are communicating with someone in the United States and to discover a new suspect. And I say the FBI, it really is an FBI program, and the reason the NSA has it is because they have the database capabilities. The FBI can't do what the NSA does. Okay. But it's acquired by the FBI and used by the FBI.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you very much for staying right squarely within your allotted time. So I'll turn then to Eliza Goitein, and basically the same question, whether there are significant dangers to freedom of speech, association, and privacy, and particularly, I think Stephen Bradbury drew the issue very sharply when he said that because there's no content, there's no concern about chilling First Amendment rights, and that because there's no content obtained by the government, there is no privacy risk. So would you like to address that?
Thanks, Steve, and thanks again to the law school. Steve did ask us to stay away from some of the strictly legal issues, but as Steve Bradbury pointed out, there's actually a real intersection here between the legal question, the legal test under the Fourth Amendment, and the policy question we should all be asking ourselves, and that is, do Americans have a reasonable expectation of privacy in this information? So that joins the question of what is this metadata anyway? And government officials have taken great pains to describe it as only telephone numbers, only the length and the time of calls. It's not content, it's only these numbers. And that really troubles me that this argument is being made because they know better. Metadata, as many experts will tell you, can be even more revealing than content. Suppose that somebody dials a suicide hotline several times and hangs up. There is no content, but the actual fact of the repeated calls to a suicide hotline is quite revealing Same thing with calls to a divorce lawyer, calls to an abortion clinic. And when you add the kind of analytic firepower that sophisticated computer algorithms provide, you can find out a wealth of personal information about people's relationships, their political affiliations, their religious beliefs, and more. Yes, it's true, they only get phone numbers. They don't get names. It's child's play to find the names to connect to these phone numbers. You can do it through public sources. Google any phone number and you'll probably find out whose number it is. So the administration tells us we still don't need to worry because under an order of the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court, the FISA court, the government will not actually pull any records for any particular phone number unless it has reasonable suspicion that that number is being used by a terrorist. But that's not strictly true. Once the government pulls those records, it is allowed to go as many as three hops out from the initial phone number. So if Joe Terrorist calls a restaurant to order takeout, and 3 years ago that restaurant called you to confirm a reservation, the NSA can look at all of your phone records of everyone you've called for the last 5 years. Another very relevant point, the NSA has a terrible record of compliance with the reasonable suspicion requirement. The government was basically forced to disclose a number of opinions from the FISA court, which are usually secret, and these showed that the NSA on multiple occasions operated this program in a manner that pulled records without a determination of reasonable suspicion, and on multiple occasions, government officials filed affidavits with the court that misrepresented what the NSA was doing. So we've established two points. This is very revealing information, and the government very well might see it even if you're not a terrorist. So then the question is it reasonable for us to expect this information that we voluntarily share with a telephone company to stay private? And here's where the legal doctrine as it stands, which is slightly dated doctrine, and the policy arguments diverge. Under current case law, privacy is binary. Either you tell something to no one, and it might be private, or you tell one person that information, and it has no privacy that attaches to it whatsoever. This does not reflect, I think, how most of us think of privacy. Just because you tell something personal to your mother or your best friend does not mean that you're comfortable with the whole world knowing it. And more to the point, just because you say, send an email, which means that you have in some way given that information, that email, to your internet service provider, doesn't mean that you feel that you have put it out there for the whole world to see. So privacy shouldn't be treated as a yes or no proposition. It should be about your ability to control who you share information with and under what circumstances. I had some observations about First Amendment ramifications, but I think I'm probably running short of time, so maybe I can hold off and do those. Am I short of time?
You have a minute.
Oh, okay. I'll talk about that.
45 seconds.
Okay. The purpose of the bulk collection program is to reveal associations. So right there, it implicates the First Amendment freedom of association, and the concern is that it might chill that freedom. And you know, I can hear somebody saying, come on, I mean, who is going to not call somebody because they know that the NSA is collecting their phone records? And it might seem far-fetched, but if you look at the analogous context of the NYPD's surveillance of Muslim Americans in New York City, the CUNY Law School and some other organizations did a study of the effect of the surveillance on Muslim Americans, and they reported that they had become, or the people who were interviewed reported that they had become skittish about people whom they associated with, and that, for instance, if there were people who were who held religious views that were unconventional, unusual, maybe you know, very passionate, that they would avoid those people, even if there was no indication of terrorist sympathies or no intimation of violence. And so, it really was affecting people's freedom of association, and that's exactly what you worry about when the government starts keeping an eye on who we associate with.
Thank you very much, Liza. Our first two panelists are both lawyers, and they've done a very good job of doing exactly what I had in mind, which is to talk about the underlying legal values and not trying to get too deeply into the weeds of a specific Supreme Court decision or the statutory wording. And that's really what's most relevant to us thinking about going forward, where we should structure these programs, how Congress should think about authorizing or limiting them. So our third panelist, Shane, is a journalist and can address the same issue from his perspective, whether there are dangers here to First Amendment and Fourth Amendment values.
There's a Scott Shane, too, so we get mixed up sometimes.
tripping up Shane Harris.
It happens. So I am not a lawyer, so I don't approach this usually in my reporting from the standpoint of the legalities of it. But what I try and do is understand what the NSA and the FBI are doing, and importantly, why they're doing it. And I like this question, the way it's been phrased, about the potential implications for this program, because, you know, so far I would say that we haven't necessarily seen any great evidence of abuse under this program. I'm also not persuaded that we've seen any great examples of its utility, that it is definitely sort of like the secret ingredient that allows the national security agencies and the FBI to foil terrorist attacks. Although that's a hugely important part of the discussion, it just happens that, you know, all of these instances in which the program is used, almost all of them are classified, and very few have been publicly revealed. I think it's important, though, to take kind of a little bit of a step back and understand the context in which the NSA put this program into place and how it also is obviously used by the FBI, which leads domestic terrorism investigations. The NSA, sort of to put it very bluntly, I think views metadata as more important than content and more useful and illuminating than content. Just thinking about this logically, you know, terrorists, one presumes, are going to take some efforts to encrypt their communications and probably speak in code and do things such that if you ever intercepted an email message or a phone call, they might try to make it difficult for whoever was listening to know what they were up to. But metadata, you can't really alter. It's a record of who called who was in touch with whom. And the NSA, you know, since before 9/11 too, but really after 9/11, has spent a lot of time and energy trying to make use of big data and huge amounts of data to understand networks and how people are associated with one another. So that is really kind of how they approach this problem. And the FBI can use this in very discreet ways of searching a phone number that was discovered in the computer or the notebook of a terrorist captured in Afghanistan to try and find out if anyone's in the database that they know. And that's kind of a discreet use. But the concept at play here from the NSA's perspective is you need to have all of this information to be able to scan against it. And Keith Alexander, who is the director of the agency, General Alexander, has actually talked about this in some really revealing terms, I think, in congressional testimony, where, I mean, effectively what they're saying is in order to find a needle in a haystack, we need the haystack. We need to have all of the data so that we can, in his words, even go back in time and understand the relationships between people that we're interested in and where they may have been in years past and who they may have been in touch with that they're not any longer. So that's sort of how they come at this. My question has always been driving me as a journalist, though, on this is, does it actually work? I mean, because the potential for abuse, it seems to me, is clearly there. If you are taking every phone record, every record of every call made inside the United States and putting it in a secret database in an intelligence agency, there's a potential for abuse there. We haven't seen evidence of it. That doesn't mean it wouldn't happen. It doesn't mean it couldn't happen under different circumstances. I mean, following another terrorist attack on the order of 9/11, most people who I know in the national security community presume that the safeguards and the rules that are in place right now, probably many of them would go away. It's always this question of potential abuse, I think, that you have to keep in mind when you're talking about this data. My fellow panelist here also already mentioned sort of got at the breadth of the data that's in there when you talk about the hops that analysts can go out when they search at one number and they search that person's contact and that person's contacts. You know, NSA has tried to, I think, portray the database as discreetly used, but the data itself is vast and has potential to touch on millions of people in this country and all around the world. We have seen some instances, yes, there's no content in there, but we've seen instances of the NSA using the database inappropriately. Inadvertently inappropriately, it actually looks like. One of the things that I've been concerned about as I've reported on the agency is there's so much data and the databases are so big that I think frequently the agency's own analysts don't know how to make sense of all they're collecting. There were some documents that were recently declassified that told some really interesting stories about analysts who, at the NSA, thought they were searching one database, but actually were searching this metadatabase, and they didn't realize that they didn't have the proper rules and predicates to be in that database in the first place. So there's just so much data that there are times it seems where analysts don't even know what they're scanning and what they're searching. We're learning a lot more in these dribs and drabs about how this program works through the leaks, but I think it's that key question again is the potential for abuse, and to guard against that, I think you need to know how it's being used, and from my point of view, that's why the leaks have performed actually such an important public service.
Thank you very much. Rather than giving the panelists a specific chance to respond directly to what they said just now, I want to turn to the second question. That is whether there are alternatives that, for example, pulling back on the substantive authority to collect this data, whether there are alternatives that could serve most of the important counterterrorism purposes at least as effectively or almost as effectively with at less risk to the First and Fourth Amendment concerns. So I'll take a slightly different order this time and turn first to Liza Goitein.
So the most obvious alternative to bulk collection is to do what the plain language of the statute suggests, which is to establish the relevance of the information that the government wants to examine before collection instead of after collection. Now remember, the NSA says it doesn't touch this data until it knows exactly the telephone number that it wants to investigate and it has reasonable suspicion on that number. So the NSA could go to the telephone company with that number and get all the same records about who that person communicated with. They could even go out hops, go back to the telephone company and say, do two or three more hops. And they would get the same information without vacuuming up everyone's data. Now, Steve, the way you've asked the question, which is are there alternatives that would be equally effective, requires me to really address the effectiveness of the bulk collection program, and that is admittedly difficult to do given, you know, for outsiders who aren't privy to the classified information. But I can say this. The administration has every incentive to present the strongest possible case that it can in support of this program. And yet no official has said words to the effect that this program has been instrumental in thwarting a significant terrorist attack that could not have been thwarted using Section 215 without the bulk collection aspect, which is really the question. And the FISA court itself, back in 2009, questioned the utility of this program. The FISA court has access to the classified information. The court said, you've only opened three preliminary investigations in 3 years as a result of this program. Now, the opinion that was released yesterday that the court wrote was intended for public consumption, that opinion had some conclusory statements about this program being useful and necessary, but that's a very different from what the court was saying when it thought it was speaking off the record. Still, let's use our imagination in terms of how bulk collection might be useful. And the best argument I've heard is that it allows the government to keep data going back 5 years, whereas some of the companies might get rid of it in 18 months. So if your first lead in a terrorism case comes 18 months after all the terrorists have stopped talking to each other, you might be out of luck if you haven't saved all that data. This strikes me as potentially the equivalent of the ticking time bomb scenario in the torture debate, in the sense that I genuinely don't know how often the trail goes cold in a terrorism case 18 months before the investigation gets anywhere. But again, let's assume that it is a real problem. It proves way too much. Third parties eventually will get rid of the information you give them. Any kind of information that Americans give to third parties could conceivably prove useful in a terrorism investigation somewhere down the line. The logical endpoint of this approach is that the government under Section 215 can and should collect all information we give to all third parties and keep it indefinitely. I also don't think it's a reasonable alternative to require the phone companies to keep this information for 5 years, as some people have proposed. I would say that the government has gone far enough and perhaps a bit farther in terms of pressing the companies into service as counterterrorism agents, given the remarkably free flow of information between the companies and the NSA. It would be a grave mistake, I think, to mandate the creation of rich databases of information by private companies for the NSA to mine. And honestly, the fact that the companies have no interest right now in keeping this information indefinitely is the best civil liberties protection we have. Now, if you buy that it is absolutely essential to have this information for 5 years, there is an option that would give you the same access with better protections, and that is to allow the collection up front and then require the NSA to go back to the FISA court and get a court order anytime it wants to query that data. And at that point, the NSA would have to show the FISA court that there was reasonable suspicion for the query. That happens roughly 300 times a year. That may sound like a big burden to put on the government and the court, but then when you consider that the government also files 2,000 applications with the FISA court every year for wiretap orders, it's not, frankly, that much more. But for reasons that I will get to later, I don't think this post-collection safeguard adequately protects our privacy, so I would really much prefer to see bulk collection ended.
Thank you very much. So this time I'll turn second to Stephen Bradbury. Same question. Are there alternatives that could serve most of the counterterrorism purposes almost as effectively, but at less risk to Fourth Amendment and First Amendment values?
Well, I don't think so, realistically. The NSA and others in the intelligence community and the Obama administration have consistently said this program with this metadata database and the capability it provides is a unique tool to identify new phone numbers that they didn't know about before that are associated with specific overseas terrorist organizations, international terrorist organizations that are posing a threat to the United States. And that this is this particular database gives the FBI and the NSA that unique capability on a real-time basis to see the connections, identify the patterns. And it's not done by churning through the data with some kind of osterizer that identifies patterns. They can't do that. The court order strictly limits them to only entering and querying the database when they have a specific number with a reasonable suspicion that it's associated with an overseas terrorist organization. But then when they do query, it does show, as Liza said, the connections to that number. And you can go out two hops, three hops, and see a cluster of connections and identify patterns. And that's critical to being able to identify a new phone, maybe the same terrorist, who they may switch phones every week or 2 weeks, and this is a tool that enables the investigators to see the new phone number that that same person is using, but also to identify new affiliates that they didn't know about. And then if they see something new, they can go back in time with this five-year database, and if an event happened that was investigated or a near attack or a plot 3 years ago, and they knew at the time of four individuals who were in the cell associated with that, and they go back to that two-week period in time 3 years ago with this new number they have, and they can query, and they see a connection. There was a fifth member of that cell that they didn't know about at the time. Then they can open a regular FISA investigation and do a full investigation. Those things happen all the time. That is an important contribution to the counterterrorism effort. The test is not, is this particular database instrumental in stopping a catastrophic attack that you can point to? It's the day-to-day input, and that's the value of of this as a tool to enable an investigation to get off the ground. It's a critical building block in an investigation. It may not be the linchpin that caught the terrorist just before the bomb in Times Square went off, but it's an important contribution with a lot of others. So that's the way counterterrorism works. In terms of alternatives, I think I definitely agree with Liza. It's not practical to have the phone companies keep the data, because this is coming from multiple telephone companies. I mean, there are three, basically. And what the NSA does is it needs to have this database in order to preserve the data, because these companies only keep it for a few months. They don't have the need to keep it otherwise. And to integrate it together into one efficiently usable database. That's what the NSA, that's sort of the value they add to it, is to be able to use it as a single. And you need the whole, as big a box of dots as you can get, it's not everything, but as big as you can get in order to find that connection to that new dot you didn't know about before. And if it were under the control of the phone companies, well, what would that mean? Well, that would mean they would contract with a private contractor, not the government, to oversee it. And there'd be private contractors running this database. I think it would be less efficient, it would be less susceptible to strong oversight by Congress, the inspectors general, and the court, and it would be less safe and more apt to be abused. Right now, it's in a segregated database and under court order cannot be accessed except as I described and cannot be used for any other purpose. I certainly agree with Shane that the worry here should be the potential for abuse, and certainly there is a potential for abuse. I would be one of the first to agree whenever the government has a large amount of data that might be used for the wrong purpose and might be abused in that way, and that's why we have the inspectors general, the FISA court that oversees everything and approves it, the intelligence committees of the House and Senate, which get into the wires on these programs, and frankly, in this case, every single member of Congress that voted to renew Section 215 of the Patriot Act in 2011 had the opportunity to know all the details about this program, and that's just the truth. And so it's been extremely closely overseen and watched, which I know is the next question, I guess, Steve, that you're going to get into.
Thank you for the segue. But first, we have to hear from Shane Harris, and there's probably nobody outside the government who is as close to the actual day-to-day workings of this and to the people who are involved in this. So it'd be very interesting to hear his perspective on this question of whether there are alternatives that might achieve most of the same purposes at less risk.
So as a preamble to that, I just wanted to say that the way that Steve described the utility of the metadata base as not being the question not to ask is, does it stop the bomb going off from Times Square, but rather it's the sort of the day-to-day inputs and the accretion of understanding. That is probably one of the best and most persuasive defenses of the database that I've heard from anyone who's ever been in government or is currently there. And I would just say that to all of this, it baffles me that this administration has not done a better and more persuasive job of defending these programs. I'm not saying that they should be defended, you know, because of any particular personal interest in defending them, but it has been remarkable the degree to which the administration has been playing defense on this and has not done a better job of coming out and saying, look, this is how it's used and this is why we do it. It has actually been more of a defense of the legal aspects of it, which I think start to tune people out. So maybe they should be doing what we're doing on this panel. But anyway, I think that's a very good explanation of why the NSA and the FBI think this is essential. Alternatives to doing it, I'm going to go through three that have actually been taken seriously in the past couple of months. One is just to stop doing it. There are many members of Congress seem to think that would be a good idea. There was a vote about 6 or 7 weeks ago, I think, in the House to significantly scale back the metadata program, and I, for one, I think a lot of my colleagues as well, were very surprised at how close that came to passing. That was probably the most significant step by members of Congress to wholesale scale back or claw back a surveillance authority that had been granted that I've seen since 9/11, and it nearly passed. It gives you some sense of the appetite for significantly reining this in. The other is to change the architecture of how the program works, which would mean storing the data someplace else, letting it stay at the phone companies, making them hang on to it for 5 years. The cost of storage would be practically trivial, and if it were any added cost, the government could pay for it. Or possibly setting up a third-party neutral arbiter that you go to through some process that is audited and vetted, and that's a trusted third party holding the data. NSA has actually indicated that they would be open to possibly changing the architecture in some way of this. I think that they probably realize that politically, if it means saving the program and saving the metadata base to have it put someplace else, they might be open to doing that. And I don't think that would be necessarily a very complicated a change to the architecture. I mean, and you could probably even put some more safeguards into it, and you might even be able to do some more public auditing. You know, why couldn't we know every 6 months how many times the database has been queried? I mean, we know it exists, right? I mean, at this point, why not have more transparency onto how it's actually being used? And it wouldn't surprise me, frankly, if there were some at NSA that would be very much in favor of doing that. And I think they feel that it would help them defend the program better and explain to people how it's used. You know, the downside of that, of course, is, are you comfortable with having a phone company having 5 years of your records? I mean, why should a private company be trusted more than the government? And I think that's certainly a valid question in all of this. The third way to talk about this is restricting the access to the database itself. So making it harder to query, raising the bar for how you get into the database if you're an analyst, limiting the number of people who have access to it. There's some indication that that has happened. So in documents that were recently declassified by the government, we found out that there were, I think it was several thousand phone numbers that were being searched against the database, but without what they call reasonable articulable suspicion, or RAS. So numbers that they were searching for, but what they shouldn't have been searching for. Well, a lot of this was because there were automatic software programs running within NSA that were doing that querying, and sort of boiling it down here, all that human beings didn't know what the computers were doing and what they were looking at. NSA's solution to that was basically to unplug the software from that database and stop doing automated searches of it. It's a pretty, you know, brutal kind of way of fixing the problem, is just to say unplug from it, you know, or to limit the access severely. But what that shows, I think, is that there are ways that you can sort of crank the dial on how much access you get to that data and how you control it internally. That may be another alternative to what, you know, may be sort of viewed as a more wholesale kind of access to the data or collection. One other sort of, you know, caveat to this to remember, and we're talking about this database, I understand, for today, but it's not like this is the only massive information collection effort going on within the NSA, right? So the PRISM system, which we're not talking about today, is collecting internet data. NSA, we know, is collecting all encrypted communications that travel across the internet to try and break them at a later date. So it's important, as we're talking about this program and how we modify that, these same questions can be asked of other programs. This one has been getting the most attention, I think, because, frankly, we know the most about it, and the scope of it is really so extraordinary.
Thank you very much. This time, Shane Harris gets to start, so we'll go right back to you. But the question we want to focus on now is whether the existing oversight procedures are adequate. And I suppose we could think about that question as it applies if we make no changes in the aspects of the program we've talked about so far, whether different oversight procedures should be put in place, or whether even with changes and greater protection in the program, we might still need greater oversight. So what I think would be interesting to address is whether there are significant weaknesses in the oversight structures that we currently have. Stephen Bradbury mentioned a number of the points of oversight that we've had in place already. So it would be interesting to talk about whether that structure has significant weaknesses and whether it could be changed so that we do a better job of oversight without compromising the counterterrorism effort. So Shane, do you want to start with that?
Yeah, so if the question is the oversight sufficient today, I think if you polled people in Washington who are concerned with this issue at the policy level, the answer probably would be no. And that doesn't mean that even if you believe in oversight and think that the oversight is sufficient, you probably believe now it's not enough because you have not persuaded the majority of the American public that the oversight is sufficient. So something has got to change, even if you believe that the oversight now is pretty good. And I think it is going to change. So we've seen legislation proposed to implement an adversarial sort of aspect to the FISA court. So right now, you know, the government goes to the FISA court, there's no one arguing the other side on matters of constitutional law. There's been a bill proposed, and maybe it has a good chance of passing too, to in instances where the court is being asked to decide to weigh constitutional matters, you know, that there's someone else arguing the other side of this. That's one way of doing it. There can be more public reporting. The intelligence agencies, and particularly through the Director of National Intelligence, has now set up a Tumblr page. You may have seen this, where they're actually, it's true, where they're putting declassified FISA court opinions. They dumped 1,800 pages of material the other day. It's pretty astounding. You know, and that lets people like me and other experts, you know, go through it and find out what they're doing and ask more questions. So I think that that's probably a step in the direction of more oversight. You know, I've been, you know, generally impressed with, you know, with the amount of information that they're putting out there. I think, though, that a lot of this does is going to come back to Congress. So it was made, reference was made earlier to members of Congress getting briefings on the Patriot Act, this aspect of the Patriot Act, before they were asked to vote on it. You know, I one former senior Justice Department official who was involved in this, you know, really got animated when he talked to me about this and saying, you know, how dare these members of Congress come out now and say they didn't know this. We went to extraordinary lengths to make sure that they knew. We gave them briefings we would never give to a rank and file House member. I think that there's gonna have to be some sort of soul searching and some mending between the legislative and the executive branch on this in a big, big way, because frankly, there is so much trust that has been lost now. I think even people who had great trust and faith in senior intelligence officials and leaders on the committees now, in some cases, don't trust them. They don't believe that they've been told everything there is to all these programs because, you know, they keep reading about in the newspaper things that were either news to them or they didn't fully understand. So there's going to be, I think, it's going to be incumbent upon executive branch officials and legislators, you know, to get smarter on this stuff and to demand more access to it and probably, frankly, to pay more attention. You know, and the Patriot Act has been reauthorized, I forget how many times now, in the past decade or so, but every time it comes up, there's this whole question of, well, does members of Congress even know what they're voting on? Well, you know, if the executive branch says you can have the briefing and you don't take the briefing, you know, well, then it's sort of your fault. But if the briefing didn't have all the information, then what aren't you telling us? So that trust is eroding, and that's got to be repaired. And the last part of this, and this is a self-serving observation, obviously, but I think, look, most of what we're talking about here and we know is because people in my profession wrote about it. And you can take issue, if you want, with Snowden and his motivations and how the press has reported this. And there's been varying degrees in the way we've reported this and how professional I think we've been even. But I think we play an indispensable role in this whole conversation. And by and large, I've actually been very proud of my profession for the way that we've acquitted ourselves in trying to get this information out and do it in a responsible way. That's indispensable.
Great, thank you very much. So next, Liza Goitein, do you want to address that? And
sure.
Perhaps if I think Shane elaborated in depth on some of the alternatives that would involve greater oversight, and he touched a little bit on the difference in perceptions between the administration and Congress on how much oversight has been made available. But I wonder if you could focus perhaps a little bit not only on ways to make oversight stronger, but what's your sense about why or whether oversight is sufficient now? In what ways is it weak?
Well, I think it's quite clear that existing oversight procedures are inadequate because the main purpose of these procedures in this context is to ensure that the NSA is adhering to the limits on accessing and using the data. And in a 2009 opinion of the FISA court, the court took the NSA to task for repeatedly and systematically violating the rules for accessing the data over a three-year period since the inception of the program. And the court found that this critical aspect of the program had essentially not functioned effectively the whole time the program had been in place. Now, why did it take the court 3 years to find out about this? It's simple. As the chief judge of the FISA court told the Washington Post, the court is absolutely dependent on the NSA to provide it with complete and timely and accurate information. The court has no independent capacity to monitor the NSA's compliance with the law or with the court's orders. And on multiple occasions, the NSA has given the court bad information. Now, there are ways to strengthen the court's oversight. Shane mentioned one of them. You know, the way that inconvenient truths come up in regular court proceedings is through discovery. And there is no discovery in FISA court proceedings because there's only one party, the government. So there are these proposals out there to add an adversarial element. What I would say is this shouldn't just be for arguing legal issues, but that these attorneys, these ombudsmen, should have exactly the same access to the factual record that the NSA has at its disposal, and not just what the NSA chooses to present. Now, congressional oversight is also a problem, to be sure. The Judiciary and Intelligence Committees, I worked on the Judiciary Committee, I should know the name. They were briefed, they were apprised of this program. Members of Congress outside of the committee had the opportunity to see a classified report that the executive branch prepared. That report has been disclosed, we've seen it. It's a puff piece, it's an op-ed. If the members of Congress knew enough to ask for more details and were allowed to see more details, they would have had to have done it under circumstances where they could not take notes and they could not get any assistance from their own staff. This is not meaningful access. Also, let's be honest. Let's suppose that every member of Congress had free access to all of the relevant information. What is their incentive to act? Members of Congress answer to their constituents. It's a democracy. They answer to their constituents and, you know, to their donors, as we all know. And they have limited political capital to spend on battling the administration on counterterrorism issues. Other than the occasional Senator Feingold or Senator Wyden, what member is going to stick their neck out on an issue that their constituents and donors don't know about and therefore don't care about? Now, don't get me wrong, I'm in favor of strengthening oversight for Congress and for the committees and for the FISA court. But oversight is not the answer to every civil liberties problem, and it is never a substitute for adequate substantive limits on what the government can do. If the law allows the government to go too far, it doesn't help matters to have oversight bodies in place watching it happen. Now, in this case, the law was interpreted to allow the NSA to collect all Americans' phone records. Once the NSA has those records, any way you slice it, you are relying on the NSA to police itself. Yes, the NSA is supposed to report instances of noncompliance to various oversight bodies, but what if it doesn't? Are the intelligence committees and the FISA court going to come into a forensic inspection of the NSA's databases? I submit that any program which allows dragnet collection up front and then imposes the limitations after the fact is inviting abuse. And the answer in that situation is not better oversight. It's changing the law to put stronger limitations in place.
Thank you very much. Stephen Bradbury, you had to start, so now you'll get the last word. And there are two quite different questions really on the table. One is, looking closely at the existing oversight structure that we have, is it weak and ineffective, or is it sufficient? And secondly, what alternatives could we imagine that might have involved more vigorous oversight without hampering the counterterrorism effort?
Well, thanks. I guess I want to talk about two types of oversight. And the first I'll start with is the traditional oversight that the government does within the executive branch and Congress of the executive branch, and then in these areas where we involve a court, but the judicial branch as well, sort of within the government oversight. Very important traditional oversight. I really think, from my experience, it's fair to say that these programs that are the focus of so much public debate now of the NSA, really since 2006, have seen the most extensive and involved oversight of any federal government program, whether national security program, administrative regulatory program, or law enforcement program ever in the history of the United States. The oversight and the layers of oversight are so extensive, and they've been added on to over the years as compliance issues certainly have arisen. It's a highly technical, complicated set of operations that the NSA is doing, and mistakes have definitely been made, and the court has called them. And if you read those 1,800 pages of court opinions, You will see the difficult job that the lawyers at the National Security Division at the Justice Department have when they have to go face the music before Judge Bates or Judge Reggie Walton of the FISA court, because those opinions are hard-hitting and demanding. Now, Liza is absolutely right that the judges on the court themselves don't have large staffs and ability to monitor and do examinations and audits. These compliance issues were a matter of self-reporting by the NSA to the court, but that's because they were discovered in the case that Liza was talking about by Justice Department lawyers doing regular reviews and finally learning or dawning on them that something was technically being done that didn't match the way it had been explained to the court, immediately notified the court, all you know what broke loose, and the court, you know, said, you got to get in here, you got to be a full explanation, affidavits, et cetera, et cetera. You got to give me the names of everybody who knew it. I mean, the court really went, you know, down into the wires to get to the truth. The same thing happens with inspectors general within the executive branch, and they've added new ones through the reform statutes that Congress has passed, and the staffs of the intelligence committees on the Hill. These programs are the programs that have been most thoroughly examined by those intelligence committees, I think, in the history of those committees, in terms of the staff work, the repeated visits to NSA, because of the huge sensitivity of these issues. So in terms of oversight, I think historically, you probably have never seen any programs that match these levels of oversight. Now, oversight is never perfect, and it's chronically the case in Washington that when the you-know-what hits the fan and something is disclosed, the members of Congress on the committees usually say, oh, I didn't understand that, or that's not what they told me, you know, which doesn't match up with the memories of the executive branch briefers who thought that was all fully out there in the committees. That's usually what happens. In this case, actually, with a couple of exceptions on the committees and the leadership of those intelligence committees have stood very firmly behind the NSA and supported these programs and the conduct of the NSA, and nobody has said any intentional abuse occurred. But there's always that potential, and that's why the oversight is critical. But let me just talk about the more important kind of oversight. And, you know, you can say what you want about Mr. Snowden and the leaks and the journalism of The Guardian, etc. But we are now experiencing the more important and effective oversight, and that is public scrutiny and accountability and public debate. And I welcome it personally. I think I appreciate being able to actually come out and talk about these issues now. For years, I wasn't able to talk about these programs and these issues. It's very healthy for the nation, I think, for the whole process, for our constitutional government. It's just usually not possible. It is frankly not possible when you're talking about these highly sensitive national security programs. And you can debate whether more of it should have been public and discussed, but that's water under the bridge now, because it sure is public now, and there's a big debate, and this is part of it, and your questions and your participation is critical. I frankly think at the end of this whole debate, maybe months down the road, these programs will largely remain intact, and I think that will be the ultimate oversight judgment of these programs. And I have more to say on that topic, but I'll...
Thank you very much.
The hook is being pulled.
I'm very grateful to our panelists for saving me from the most unpleasant job of a moderator, which is to bang the gavel and to tell them to stop. Every one of them stayed right squarely within their allotted time, so I'm very grateful for that. Stephen Bradbury's last comments really do leave us with a paradox that he himself underlined, and that is that... even though many of the oversight structures have been in place for a long time, a very important part of the transparency that we're seeing now came about only because of what the administration alleges was very, very serious felony on the part of Edward Snowden. And the administration, as everybody knows, is going to enormous lengths to try to bring him to justice. So, if the kind of transparency that we're seeing now is an important part of a viable oversight system, then that we might think that in itself shows that there's something deeply wrong with the structures that we have, because the structures that we have are precisely designed to prevent the public from being involved and making a judgment, even on the meaning of the laws that, that Congress had, has supposedly passed. One other point that might be worth flagging in terms of this question of classification and secrecy, the fact that so many top secret documents are now being made available, and any of you, if you've downloaded the FISA court opinion that was released yesterday, you'll see that across the top of every page in bold black letters is, are the words top secret, which are now crossed out because it's declassified. But we can now, each of us, make a judgment about whether there was a plausible justification for treating a legal interpretation of the administrative search doctrine as top secret and on something that couldn't be shared with the American public. So having said that, another fringe benefit of our the respect that our panelists have shown for the format is that we have about just under 20 minutes. There are classes that start at 2, so we want to be sure to break at 1:50, but we have 15, 20 minutes for questions. I'm going to try very hard to take them in order, but if you have a question, if you raise your hand, no questions?
I think there are mics actually set up.
We could, perhaps one thing we could do is if those of you who have questions could just approach one of the microphones and wait in line, that would probably be a very easy way to make sure that we keep a queue objectively. So if you want to start.
Thank you, Professor Schulhofer, for organizing this panel, moderating it today. Thank you to all the panelists for being here. My name is Thelma Rizvi, and I'm a 1L. And I had, this comment is related to Ms. Eliza's comments. I found some of what you were saying to be a little sensationalist, from NSA giving the court bad information to continuous abuse, even though your colleague said that there hasn't really been shown to be continuous abuse, to dragnet collection. We can debate. I think most people in the panelists can debate about a lot of these things, but I think I would be remiss when you had tried to make a link between the NSA surveillance programs and NYPD surveillance programs on Muslim Americans. And as a Muslim American, I know that the NSA has an employee resource group which does internal policing, and I know that was one of your concerns as well, internal policing of such a large agency, where Muslims are allowed to use 20% of duty time, paid duty time, to inform leaders, General Alexander, the Dieter, about Islamic culture, to ensure that, you know, there's no technical demographic analyticals being used, like if the words, you know, Muslim or prayer come up. Like, these Muslims within the agency, who are all top secret cleared intelligence agents, are able to inform the NSA of how to essentially do responsible reporting without it being discriminatory towards the Muslim American population. Those types of efforts are not happening at the NYPD. NYPD surveillance programs and the issues associated are extremely different from those at the NSA. And I wanted to clear that for the audience so there was no link being made. My question now is to Mr. Harris. Mr. Harris, I love, you know, what you were saying about trust and how the agency and the government has so many defensible positions, but they haven't been able to make their defense. My question for you is, I feel that the trust is also between the government and the media. So coming from your sector, do you think that it would be practical, or what would you recommend if, say, there was, you know, a cabinet of 5 top secret cleared reporters who are constantly having interviews with government officials and NSA senior executives to build that trust? What kind of practical avenues could you suggest for building trust between the media community and the NSA community?
Right, thank you.
Could I have just a quick minute to respond?
No, I think we better go to the question. I'm sorry, but I apologize.
Moderator, faux pas.
And I should have stressed before, I put a lot of emphasis on how much time we have for questions, but actually we have a lot less now, and I have to ask the people asking the questions to try to ask a very short question, and we would have to discuss issues about the NYPD surveillance program on another occasion. So my apologies to the Brennan Center.
I'll be brief, and for the record, would gladly yield my time to my colleague here. But it's an interesting question. I mean, the model of giving reporters security clearances, I don't think would work. I don't think the government would trust us quite that much. But what does happen is that, you know, public affairs offices, you know, routinely make available senior members of the administration and senior intelligence officials to have background briefings with reporters so that we can ask these questions. You know, I would like to see more of that and more openness with them. And what you really find, though, is that relationships between reporters and the people they cover is very dependent on personalities, individual relationships. You know, but by and large, I feel like, you know, this administration has been pretty good at making people available to talk about this. You know, that said, you know, that they're doing it because they're on the defensive, obviously. They weren't coming and calling us up and saying, hey, you want to hear about this metadata program, you know, up until it was revealed. I don't think there's anything programmatically that should be done, because I also would not want to see members of my profession given clearances and then brought in, because then they would be restricted in what they could say. So it just works better if we keep that relationship unofficial, and it protects it for everyone better.
Yeah, thank you. I guess the next question is over in this microphone on my left.
There was a suggestion that we re-examine the basic Fourth Amendment principle that you have no expectation of privacy in information that you turn over to private parties or to third parties. I was wondering if you could delve into that a little bit and tell us how that worked doctrinally and how it would be an improvement over what we have now. Thank you.
That sounds like it's a question primarily for Liza, so do you want to take that first?
Sure. So I think that the case law is, we're seeing hints that the case law might start to change on that, because if you follow that principle through to its, you know, faithfully, then the content of emails that you send are not private under the Fourth Amendment. And in fact, right now, the government's position is that is true. The content of your emails are not private. It is merely statutory protection for your emails under the Electronic Communications Privacy Act. There has been one court, the Sixth Circuit, said, no, that's wrong. You need probable cause and a warrant under the Fourth Amendment to get the content of emails. You've also seen hints of a change in terms of the Supreme Court. There was a decision, I can't get in too much into the details, but in United States versus Jones, if you cobbled together the concurring opinion with the dissents, you basically had five justices saying there can be a privacy interest in information that you give to third parties. And really the question is the fundamental Fourth Amendment question, do you have a reasonable expectation of privacy in the material? And that should not depend on whether an internet service provider is involved.
Thank you. Stephen, do you want to comment on that?
No, I'll let the next question.
Okay.
Does somebody want to ask me if I can answer the other one?
Well, I could. No, I think the doctrinal issue, as the panelists said in pushing back against my rule, was really embedded in the underlying concerns about what is private, what is threatening, what values does it threaten if the government knows who you see, who you talk to. And this is a place where the Fourth Amendment and First Amendment values very much intersect, because you may not care if the government knows what books you read, or you may not even care if the government knows that you go to a shrink, so what? But it does matter to journalists if the government knows who they're talking to. It would really be the end, I think virtually the end of Shane Harris's profession if the government can hop from one place to another and find out who he talks to in
well,
the government.
They've done it with the Associated Press.
Yeah. Yes.
And so, I mean, if they think that we're going to stop because they're monitoring our phone calls, they're kidding themselves.
But you remember the scene in The Brethren, not The Brethren, but All the President's Men, where Woodward and Bernstein meet in the basement of a garage. And we'd have to be back to that, because journalists couldn't probably assume right now that they're being monitored. And lawyers who represent clients at Guantanamo or anywhere else, and this whole range of people who have protected interests that are put at risk. So that's part of the concern. I'm sorry for taking the time. Next question.
I apologize to the moderator for interrupting him.
No.
I have a question for Mr. Bradbury. Do you think it would enhance national security if we had our postal department record the name and address of the addressee and the recipient of on all of our mail and maybe get the Fed Express and UPS involved in a similar activity and get the networks to manage to get the who it goes to, who it's from all recipients of email?
Well, it would be a very bad idea. And this gets right to the balance, right, of security and freedom and liberty. And of course, you can easily tip the balance and go way overboard. And I agree with the suggestion, I think, the assumption that that would be unreasonable, that would be excessive, and there would not be a showing that that, under the current circumstances, would be critical to national defense. And there are statutes that would limit the ability to do that, and I'm not sure that the FISA court would have the ability to authorize something like that. I haven't really thought that through. I will say, if you look back in history, that is exactly the kind of thing that President Roosevelt ordered on December 8th, 1941. So as soon as war was declared in World War II, he ordered wholesale searching of mail coming in and out of the country, listening in on all phone calls going in and out of the country, very few phone calls going in and out of the country at that time. But nevertheless, that is the kind of wartime paradigm where you know you've been struck and you don't know where the next attack is coming from, and it's high, high alert. And there was some, you know, of that sense right after 9/11, and we've been working with Congress, the executive branch, and the judicial branch to move to a more sustainable framework, which is closer to a law enforcement paradigm with the court's involvement. And God hopes we don't have to
Thank you. The irony in your question, if I can just mention it, because your question really puts a spotlight on a paradox here, because what you described, looking at the names and addresses, recipients and senders, is what the FBI calls a mail cover. And it's perfectly constitutional. The FBI's own internal guidelines limit mail covers, putting a mail cover on someone, to either a preliminary investigation or a full investigation under various circumstances. But there's nothing about it is unconstitutional, even without any predicate whatsoever. It was that assumption which led the Supreme Court to decide in the 1970s that recording phone numbers was the same thing. They took it to be a well-established principle that mail covers did not implicate the Fourth Amendment, so therefore phone covers, in effect, what they call a pen register, doesn't either. And running this movie in reverse, the problem now is not with mail covers, because they're very cumbersome and they don't give you much information, but the analogy to it on the internet gives you trillions, quadrillions of tetrabytes of data, and because it's so cheap to store it and analyze it for patterns and links, it has enormous potential, enormously invasive potential. Do you have a follow-up point?
I just wonder what Mr. Bradbury's position would have been before the NSA had undertaken these policies.
I think he told us, but did you? We'll take the next question. Thank you.
Hi. A little bit too short. So my question is that I know that we've limited the discussion here to the NSA's metadata program, but I was wondering how you felt your arguments, both supportive and critical, would apply given the wider universe of programs that are being used in conjunction today for things like PRISM.
You asking me or anyone?
I think it was just a general question.
But we don't have time to talk about all the ways it would apply to PRISM and to encryption and to email and to mail covers, which, by the way, they are doing. I thought you were asking us a trick question. I don't know how long those images are stored, but that's been publicly confirmed by the Postal Service now. but no, I think that the basic argument that I always approach it with is the question of utility. Does it work? Does it actually have, does it meet the objective that you're presumably setting out to achieve when you set up a program like this, which is to provide useful and critical intelligence that you couldn't otherwise achieve? Then you have to get into all other sorts of questions about stored data and internet data and upstream traffic and, you know, where it's stored and all of that. That implicates a whole other host of areas and statutes. But that fundamental question that I always ask is, does it work? And is it worth the trade-off in privacy and potential threat to liberty? That's the big question.
And let me briefly say that I think the main issue that comes up with the some of these the other main program you've heard about is probably PRISM Section 702, which is to intercept content of Americans' international communications. What you'll hear over and over again from government officials is that this program targets foreigners. And fair enough, under the law, it's supposed to target foreigners. But to the extent that you can pick up the foreigners' communications with Americans, that is called incidental collection of the Americans' international communication. And to the extent the procedures for targeting are not very exact and you end up getting a bunch of domestic communications, that is called inadvertent communication collection. What we have learned from Snowden's leaks is that the amount of incidental and inadvertent collection of Americans' information under this program that is targeted at foreigners is vast.
Okay, thank you. So we have time for two more questions, if they're brief. Please go ahead.
Just as an aside, I believe with the postal question, the Ryson incident recently where we saw that all postal mail is recorded on some level as far as location, so that's already being done. Very quickly, as far as utility, the Boston Marathon bombers, the Russians told both the CIA and the FBI, hey, this guy is a problem. And if this the metadata is so important, why wasn't that used to prevent the bombing?
How many questions do you have?
I wanted to say, as far as oversight, well, you have a huge percentage of the NSA being private contractors. How does that affect the efficacy of oversight when essentially they work for outside companies?
Okay, Shane, do you want to take that?
Well, the Boston question, I mean, why wasn't the metadata searched? I mean, I think that there you have, you know, perhaps the threat not being the warning not rising to the level that people felt that they had to act on it. I'm not completely up to speed on that investigation, so I want to be careful in what I say about it and what they did or what they didn't do. But generally speaking, I mean, this is one of the reasons why the NSA believes it needs to have the database is also as a preemptive measure. I mean, you ideally want to find the plot before it's executed. So it's not just about going back and tracking the networks, but about trying to find actionable intelligence that leads you, you know, to the guy that you can stop or the plot that you can disrupt. And I think that's what they're having difficulty in. Part of it is because a lot of this is classified, is coming up with examples that they can point to publicly and saying, that's where this happened because of the metadata. That's really been a challenge for NSA and for the administration at large.
Thank you. Okay, last question.
Okay. It seems like there's a consensus on the panel that oversight from the public is necessary for programs like this. So my question is, perhaps particularly for Mr. Baldwin, how do we ensure that such oversight actually happens, given that the current nature of public oversight only came about as a product of the leaks of Snowden, which I don't think we can count on happening on a regular basis going forward?
Did you want to take
that? Oh, me? Okay. Well, it is a practical problem that it can't always happen in this way, or that because of the way this happened through the leaks, et cetera, and the coverage is not something that you could have instituted by law. I mean, it was a violation of law that initiated what is now the public discussion. I frankly think, though, that as a result of this, there's no turning back to a certain extent, that it is a new normal, that there will be more. We're now getting more FISA opinions than any of us can read in a given week. I mean, things have changed as a result of this, and that will have long-term implications in terms of the ability of the American people through their elected representatives or directly in the streets to weigh in. It's just, as a practical matter, not really possible to lay out the details of very sensitive, ongoing intelligence programs. And, you know, very simply here, what the government would say is the reason it couldn't simply tell the American people that it was taking this broad interpretation of what relevance is under this Section 215 to get this whole universe of metadata was because to explain that would tip off that you had such a capability, such a program. So that's the problem. So, you know, the solution has been we have life-appointed federal judges from the third branch who sit and review and determine that the standard is met, and 14 different federal judges over the course of 6 years have, 7 years have said it's it meets the requirements of the statute, and your elected representatives in Congress conduct oversight. And, you know, you may be dissatisfied with the effectiveness of that. Well, the last thing I would say is a point about our Constitution and our constitutional system. We talk a lot about, well, the courts should do more. Are they rubber stamps or are they really effective? Congress should do more. These bureaucrats officers in the intelligence community should be better at what they do and do more. I think it really all comes down to the President of the United States, who is the one who is elected by all Americans. And traditionally and under our Constitution, it is the President who conducts these kinds of activities, these foreign intelligence programs trying to protect the United States. And the focus of accountability and public debate and, you know, the political reaction, I think, should be on the President of the United States. And, you know, I actually would like to see him stand up more and defend the programs in more detail. But
I'm sorry we have to stop there.
That's another issue.
Partly because I couldn't disagree more with the last point that was just made.
So you're going to take the last word.
No, I'm not. I'm going to I ask everyone to join me in thanking the panel.